Today is Mother's Day, and we are so excited to welcome all mothers, as well as everyone else who has chosen to worship with us. Today is a very special day as we recognize and appreciate mothers. Whether this is your first time here or you are a regular attendee, we sincerely are honored you decided to join us today. May God bless you and keep you.
Good morning. We come this morning, brothers and sisters, to worship on our Sunday morning service. We're so happy that you chose to worship with us this morning. We are overjoyed that God put it on your mind to come and worship with us through Facebook and our YouTube. Our awesome and all-knowing God has brought us again through another week, not because we've been so good, but because of His grace and His mercy. And I just want to let you know that as we come together this morning, I believe God is saying to us, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, would seek my face, would turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal the land. God is good and He's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. God is good and He is worthy to be praised. Someone, wherever you are, in your homes, in your bedroom, in your kitchen, should be shouting hallelujah right now. Lord, we thank you. We thank you and we bless your name, Lord. You've been so good. You've brought us through another week, Lord. And we thank you right now, Lord. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that you have allowed us to see another day. So many times, Lord, we take for granted that we'll wake up in the morning. And there are some, Lord, that have gone home to be with you. But in the name of Jesus, we thank you right now. We thank you because, Lord, you thought us fit to see another day. Thank you, Lord, for all that you continue doing. We bless you. We lift you up. We glory and we magnify your name. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you touch this worship service this morning. You know what we need, Lord. We're leaning and depending on you right now, Lord. You are our comforter. You are our Savior. You are our Lord. You're all that we need. Lord, we pray for those who are struggling. We pray for those who are going through issues in their life. We pray, Lord, that you will touch them as only you can. We bless you and we lift you up, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Yes, Lord. Thank
you. Hallelujah.
Bless your name, Jesus.
Name in this place, oh God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Glory to the name of God. Hallelujah. Bless you and we magnify you in this place, oh God. Your name is worthy to be praised, oh God. Oh Lord, we love you, oh God. We bless your name in this place.
Lord, you are.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you
are good and your
mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation,
people from every nation,
from generation to generation,
we worship you. We worship you for who you are.
We worship
you.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah. We worship you for who you are.
You are good.
Put those hands together.
Hallelujah.
So good, oh God. We bless your name in this place, oh God.
Here we go. Say, Lord.
Lord, you are good
and your mercy endureth forever.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good
and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord,
you are good
and your mercy endureth
forever.
Come on, all over people.
People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation,
we worship you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Worship you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We worship you for who you are.
Yeah,
you are good.
Praise your name, Jesus.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Come on, everybody. You are good.
You are good.
All the time and all the time,
you are good.
You are good all the time and all the time,
you are
good.
You are
good all the time and
all the time,
you are good. You are good
all the time
and all the time, you are good. You are good
all the time,
you are good.
You are good
all the time and all the time.
You are good.
Put those hands together.
Hallelujah.
He's good all the time.
Hallelujah.
And you are. Let's go.
You are good
all the time.
And
all the time,
you are good.
You are
good all the time. And all the time,
you are good.
You are good all the time.
And all the time,
you are good.
You are
good all the time.
And
all the time, you are
good.
People from every nation.
People from every nation
and tongue,
from generation
to generation,
we worship you.
Hallelujah.
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 We
worship you
for who you
are.
We worship, we worship,
we worship you.
Hallelujah.
We worship you
for who you are,
for who you are,
for who you are,
who you are,
for 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 who you are.
You are
good.
Hallelujah. Giving all honor and praise to God, from whom all blessings flow. We want to take a moment just to thank Pastor Perkins, the shepherd of this house, for being gracious and always willing to share his pulpit. And so this morning, I am grateful, I'm thankful that while we may not be able to gather in the sanctuary, we are reminded that it is not the building that bears witness to the sovereignty of God. It is not the building that gives testimony to God's grace. And it's not the building which embodies God's love. It is the church. It's the church that resides in us. We are the church, and the church is everywhere we are. So as much as the church gathers this morning, whether you are in your living room or in your kitchen or even in your bedroom, let the church say amen. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds to hear a word from the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God, we declare your glory on today. We acknowledge your presence and invite your Holy Spirit to surround us. We open our hearts and our minds to you, O God. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come before you in worship. I petition you now, O God, as I prepare to bring forth your word. Please cover me with your anointing. Allow your light to shine through me. I pray you bring clarity and understanding to your preached word. Remove all obstacles in order that we may recognize and receive your revelation. This I ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Our scripture this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 11 through 14. Verse 11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity." Our theme this morning is perseverance, a true testament of faith. Amen. Let me begin this morning by saying Happy Mother's Day. First of all, to our First Lady, Patricia Perkins, to all the mothers, to grandmothers, to spiritual mothers, godmothers, auntie moms, sister moms, mothers on the front lines, and all who have stepped into the celebrated role as mothers. Mothers, we care for and nurture and love their children unconditionally, no matter how young or how old they are. Mothers protect and cover their children in prayer. We weep over them and lament to God about them. But there's one thing for sure, that we never, ever give up on them. As mothers, we do this not because we are expecting anything in return, but because in the midst of this long, winding journey of motherhood, We find the blessings in God's faithfulness towards us. We find the hope in the things to come and the perseverance to do it all over again. Many of you mailed meaningful cards or sent bouquets of flowers to acknowledge the significance of today. Maybe you phoned home just to hear the joy in your mama's voice. All of these wonderful gestures of love are not uncommon, but for the most part are repeated year after year. However, today is a little different for all of us. What was once tradition has been abruptly altered. There won't be the familiar large gatherings of family members to celebrate. Families won't come together to dine at mom's favorite restaurant. Nor will there be any large family picnics or face-to-face gatherings. Shelter-in-place policies have changed our lifestyle. Activities we once took for granted have morphed into socializing via Zoom and FaceTime. We are mandated to wear masks and gloves, practice physical distancing, and work from home, all in the name of keeping ourselves and others safe. Mothers are now multitasking more than ever before. Don't get me wrong. Women have been mastering the art of multitasking for years, even before there was a definable word for doing 1,000 things at one time. But it's different now. It's different with the COVID-19 environment. This generation of mothers are expected to be on back-to-back virtual meetings, while their five-year-old knocks on the door every 5 minutes wanting absolutely nothing. In between meetings, there is homeschooling. And I want to just pause right here and ask one question. And you can raise your hand or send me a Facebook post, but I just have one question. Does anybody here know how to do or teach Common Core math? I'm just asking for a friend, because I have a true story to tell you. I sometimes do substitute teaching, and on this day, I was scheduled to teach a third grade class. So I got to class, and we have our normal reading and writing in the morning, and we do spelling, and then it was time for math. Well, I picked up the math book, and I looked at it, and I said, these kids gonna learn how to add the last column and carry the one today. Y'all know how to carry the one. 25 plus 9, 5 and 9 is 14, and carry the one. That's how we learned how to do math, how we learned how to do addition and subtraction. Because I know I am smarter than a third grader. I know I'm smarter than a third grader. But I didn't teach them the antiquated version of adding and subtraction. I studied that Common Core math book at recess, and I did teach them the proper way. Because I can just see somebody going back telling folk, Miss Aldridge taught that old way of doing math. But I didn't. I was obedient, and I taught the Common Core math. But things are different. We all recognize that extenuating circumstances may necessitate immediate change. However, it does not eliminate the fact that swift change without a process or preparation is often chaotic, difficult, and challenging at best. When unexpected shifts happen, and there is no indication when or if normalcy, as we know it, will ever make an appearance again. The scales of everyday life become unbalanced, tilted by unforeseen circumstances. It is in this season of change that one begins to wonder when God will show up. We question, how long, Lord, must we shelter in place? How long, Lord, before you remove this pandemic? How long, Lord, before you restore us back to the life that we once knew? How long, Lord, before you send these kids back to school? How long, Lord? It was the Israelite people whom also wondered how long, they would remain captive in Babylon. Jeremiah 29, chapter 29, records the story of the Israelites' exile into Babylon, a punishment from God as a result of their continued disobedience. It's an account of the prophet Jeremiah, ordained by God to speak the Lord's truth to his people who desperately wanted to return to their homeland. They were unaccepting of their fate. They were restless, wanting and demanding an answer from God immediately to when he would allow them to go home. God sometimes sends us to a place of contemplation, a place of self-reflection, a place where we can, if we so choose, allow him to minister to us as we give ourselves over to him without distraction. A place where we can recognize God's grace manifesting in our lives. A place where reconciliation and transformation happens. The idea of reconciliation, unfortunately, was not one that the people of Israel would comprehend. So much so that they turned to false prophets, proclaiming on behalf of God that their release from captivity would be imminent. God had no such plan. We have to be careful of getting ahead of God and ahead of God's plan for our life. Jeremiah, God's true prophet, upon receiving word of this misrepresentation, penned a letter, a message from God, the message of hope and encouragement, reassured the people of Judah that God had not forgotten them. This very important letter also includes a warning relating to listening to false prophets, and a clear directive from God, one that specifically instructs them on how to make the best in a difficult and unwanted situation. And so allow me, if you will, to put some context to our theme this morning, because before we can get to the promise of his plans for us, we need to know a little bit of the history. So if we go back to Jeremiah 29 and 7, it outlines God's instructions on how to live a productive life while in captivity. God says, "Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper." And then he gives them a warning. He says, "Do not let the prophets and diviners," diviners are psychics, "so do not let the false prophets and the psychics among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams that you encourage them to have, because They wanted to leave. They didn't want to be in exile, so they were pushing, you know, giving the prophets the dreams that they wanted them to have, the dreams that would say, it's time to go. They were pushing them to give them something that was not a reality. And so I say to you that we must be careful who we allow to speak over our life, or who we tell our business to, or whose advice we follow. We ought not listen or be too eager to listen to those who lack knowledge and spiritual maturity. Be wary of those folks who speak only what we want to hear. We must learn to discern the message of God for ourselves. That's why it's important to spend quality time with God in order to establish a more personal, intimate relationship with Him. Now, verse 10 records that God sets the record straight because He knew and He heard about them. He knew that they were listening to false prophets and they were believing false prophets because that's exactly what they wanted to hear. So God said, I need to set the record straight. I need to let them know that even though His promise was going to be fulfilled, because He was going to lead them out of captivity, there was no doubt about it. He was going to lead them out of captivity, but He strikes a blow to the people because His promise, He informs them that His promise would be fulfilled 70 years after they had been captured into Babylon. 70 years. This certainly was not what the people of Israel wanted to hear. They had anticipated their suffering would end quickly, which meant going home. They surely did not expect God's plan for them to include staying in Babylon, and not only staying in Babylon, but helping to prosper the nation that had enslaved them. How that would make you feel. Someone has captured you and has taken you into exile, and God tells you that you need to prosper the nation. You need to make the nation prosper, because if you make it prosper, then you prosper too. And you are there saying, I don't see that. I'm in exile. I can't go where I want to go. I can't do what I want to do. I'm in exile. So the question becomes, how do we move forward while we wait on God? How do we get through the meantime? How do we navigate what appears to be the impossible? Jeremiah 29 and 11 offers inspiration, hope, and assurance that God has not forgotten His people. It's a declaration, an affirmation, a promise from the Lord that while situations may look bleak and appear hopeless, God without question knows and declares His plan for us. A plan to give us a glorious future. God says that I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. I'm going to be real transparent here. I will be the first to admit that sometimes God's plans look a little shady to me. It looks a little shady. Not what I expect, and definitely not what I want to hear. But I've learned that when I'm tempted to go my way,
or do my own thing. I'm tempted to make my own plans. I'm reminded of God's promise that says, and we know all things work for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. I'm reminded that our destiny has already been designed and crafted by God. And if it is to be fulfilled, if God's plan is to be fulfilled in our lives, if we are to go the path that God has called us to go, we who profess our love for him must trust him and his plan, no matter how shady we think it might be. God's timing is not our timing. Therefore, we must garner our patience and exercise our faith. God's plan is to prosper us. In this context, prosper has nothing to do with money, has nothing to do with material things, things that we can touch and feel. But prosper is to grow. It's growth. It's our spiritual growth. It's our maturity, our spiritual maturity. It's to thrive. It's to flourish. It's to realize that through hope, that we have hope in present circumstances and a future that we can look forward to. However, there's one thing that God does not promise to us. He does not promise to remove us from every problematic situation. But this we can be confident in knowing, that in every situation, in everything that we do, in all that we go through, that God is in the midst. The indicator of genuine growth is demonstrated in the acts of perseverance during the struggle. It is speaking life into a dead situation by not escaping the process, but doing the necessary work that enables us to thrive in difficult situations. It's not enough just to get by or live in sorrow as if there is no hope. God wants us to prosper, to grow in our belief, to be confident, to stand boldly with conviction, because when we persevere, we find strength in the deepest recesses of our faith. We find joy in knowing that better days are coming. God knew that there would be difficult days ahead. Days where we'd lose focus. Days where there would be times we would not even feel like getting out of bed. Days where depression would just come over us like a blanket. He understood that the journey would not always be easy, but he reassures us that he will always be with us, especially in our time of need. Can I say that God is our refuge and our strength, our help in times of trouble? I call your attention to verses 12 and 13. Because after we realize that God has called us to a purpose, that while his plans for us may not be what we thought they were, and they may not come in the time that we feel that they should come, God knew that once we understood that his purpose was us to thrive in our situation, to be content in whatever situation we find ourselves in, he knew that there would be days that we couldn't focus. And so he said to us in verse 12 and 13 that when you call on me and come and pray to me, he says, I will listen to you. He says, you will seek me and find me. Understand that he doesn't just say, seek me. He doesn't just say, look for me. He doesn't just say, you know, just see if you can see me. Not only does he say, when you seek me, that you'll find me. So he's not hiding. He's not playing hide and seek with you. He says, you will seek me and then you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. So my brothers and sisters, God is saying, don't half seek him. So he's not looking for no half, you know, no half commitment. He says, seek me with your whole heart, all of your heart. And so I ask today, who is the God that we seek? Who is God that we seek? Can I tell you who God is? Who is the God that we seek? He's Adonai. He's the Lord and Master. He's Elohim. He's our God, our Creator, and he's mighty and strong. He's El Elyon, the Most High God. Oh, he is El Shaddai, our God Almighty. God is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who will provide. He is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. My God is Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner. My God goes and stands before me. He stands on the side of me. And Lord God stands and girds me up. My God is Jehovah M. Kadesh, the Lord who sanctifies and makes holy. So God sanctifies me and makes me holy. He is Jehovah Shalom. When I'm all disturbed, God is my Prince of Peace. He is Jehovah Elohim. He is our Lord God. He is Jehovah Tiskanu, the Lord our righteousness, that which is honorable and good. God is Jehovah Rohi. He is the Lord our shepherd. For the Lord my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths. For his name's sake, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you, my God, are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. God invites us to call on him and come to him in prayer. Not only does he promise to listen to our prayers, but we are comforted in knowing that when we seek him with a heart of love, we will find him. He will make his presence known. But it doesn't end there. So we come today to thank our God. We thank God for his promise of deliverance. We thank God for his faithfulness beyond measure. We are grateful that God looks beyond all of our faults and sees potential when we don't see potential in ourselves. We thank him because he believes in us more than we believe in ourselves, and he blesses us more than we could ever deserve. We thank God. We thank you, O Lord, for creating a divine destiny which promises grace and mercy and offers hope for a future filled with blessings, Lord God, only you can bring. God, we are thankful that you dwell among us, that you hear our prayers, and you answer our prayers, and you wipe our tears. Lord God, we persevere because God is our strength and our deliverer. In you, oh God, we have victory. And I just need you just for a moment, just for a moment, to raise your hands in worship. Just raise your hands with me in worship. Because God said that if I be lifted up, that I would draw all men unto me. And so I say, wherever you are, lift up the name of Jesus. Cry out unto Jesus. Let God know how much you love him. Let him know how much you appreciate him. Let him know how much you love him and you thank him. For Lord God, it's not what you do for us. Lord God, it's who you are in our lives. So Lord God, we declare here and now that we love you, that we honor you, and we bless your holy name in this place. Lord God, we ask that you bless mothers everywhere. We pray a covering over God over their lives. We ask you, oh God, to encamp the angels around them. Lord God, we ask you to look at the desires of their heart. And Lord God, whatever that may be, we ask, oh God, that you answer prayers, not only on today, but tomorrow and forevermore. For Lord God, we give you our commitment, we give you our trust, but most of all, Lord God, we give you ourselves in service unto you. And so in Jesus' name we pray, amen. We dare not be remiss and leave this place of worship without giving an invitation for those who may not know God on a personal level, for those who have not said yes to the Savior. And so we pause right now just to assure you that it's not about how much wrong you've done in the past. It's not about whether you are ready now. God is awaiting open arms, with open arms, because he is faithful. You know, our God doesn't make you come, but he says that he's always willing to accept you. And so if that's you, if you've never said yes to the Lord, and something has been said that on today, on this morning, that has brought some joy to your heart, that wants you to want to know more about Christ and who he is and how precious he is in our life, we invite you now to say yes. And so what do we do when we say yes and when we commit and want to ask God into our life and into our heart? We just pray. So if you'll pray these words, God is faithful into accepting you and you accepting him into your heart. So we just say, dear Jesus, and repeat after me. I know that I am a sinner and need your forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins. I want to turn my life over to you. And just say with your whole heart, I now invite you to come into my heart and into my life. I want to trust you as Savior and follow you as Lord. And yes, it's just that simple. We can't work our way into heaven. We can't even work our way into salvation. It's just that simple that we say yes. And if you said yes for the first time, we invite you to call the First Baptist Church office, and our administrator will give you further information. And secondly, if those of you that are listening and you don't have a church home, and you think First Baptist Church, a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church, is where you would like to fellowship, we would be glad to have you. And so we too ask you to call into our church office, and we'll be glad to get your information. And then for those that would just need a word of prayer and a word of encouragement, we're just going to spend a little time with God right now. We won't take long, but I just want to pray a covering over your life. So gracious and heavenly Father, we come to you right now, God, just to say thank you. Lord God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, Lord God, for who you are in our lives, Lord God. We thank you that you heal the hurts, oh God, that you are a way maker, God. You are a peacemaker, Lord, and you comfort us. So, God, I pray for everyone within the sound of my voice. You know what they need, oh God. You know what they are petitioning for. You said, oh God, that if we pray to you and we seek you, oh God, with our whole hearts, with all our hearts, oh God, that you shall be found and you will be found. And so, God, we come before you with our whole hearts seeking you. I pray, God, for that. I pray a blessing, oh God, over all the mothers today. I pray, oh God, that you touch their hearts and you give them joy, Lord God, on this day as we celebrate them. Help them to know, oh God, that you see them and we see them too. Lord God, we thank you, we honor you, and we magnify your holy name. These prayers, oh God, we ask in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. My last and final word, happy Mother's Day to all. Amen.
I pray that you've been blessed by the worship and the word on today. It is our desire that you have experienced the love of God to such a degree you will share it with others.
To see what God is doing in the life of First Baptist Church, connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, or on our website at www.fbpittsburgh.org.
Also, if you've been led to sow into this ministry, click on the Give link on any platform.
Until next time, Happy Mother's Day.